Okay, so welcome everyone. I hope you can hear me loud and clear. Good. So we are going to talk about function objects today and how to use them and mainly how to couple them. So it's going to be like beginner training, but I hope it's going to be helpful for your daily life with OpenFOAM and the post-processing of your simulation data. So first of all, thanks to the organizer of the OpenFOAM Workshop. It's a pleasure to be here. And yeah, let's start. So being from ESI, OpenCFD, there is the standard marketing slide that you need to look at and listen to me. And but for that, you will have some gadgets. I brought some pens and I'll hand them over afterward for your patience. So how do we work with OpenFOAM at OpenCFD and ESI? So there is the team doing OpenFOAM development, and usually our developments are both industry and community driven. As you know, we have two releases per year. 2306 just came out a few days ago. It fulfills Q&A standards and it's open source. As a company, we do offer support and services around OpenFOAM, and this implies bespoke developments, custom support, and projects on demand. We also offer trainings. They either public trainings, you see the calendar in our on our website, and then customized trainings that can be delivered at the customer side. And you'll see on our website, foundation, advanced, and several application trainings for that. Okay, so as an outline of this training today, we will check out the new documentation of OpenFOAM briefly. We will have then, I call them hands-on, but it's gonna be me showing you different function object applications for post-processing and then some final remarks. So if we start with the documentation, we do have a new brand new user guide. You might have seen it in the release notes of 2306. And we are pretty proud of that because it's gonna be also a community project where users of OpenFOAM can also contribute to extend the user guide. I'm gonna quickly try to open it. Let's see if it's gonna be shared. And this is how it looks like. All the documentation that you see here, it is hosted on GitLab. It's a public repository by now, and anyone can do a Git clone or fork it, create your own content, and then you can do a merge request as you would do for the source code to improve or enhance the OpenFOAM documentation. And we really hope that the community will engage on this project with us. Here you have a search. Either you're gonna be looking into the documentation or you can also look into the source code depending where you are searching. And yeah, you can find most of the content that we had in the former extended user guide, but much more by now. It is work in progress. It's gonna receive updates I would say almost daily basis. And yeah, we really hope that you'll also get involved into that. So I'm going to go back to my slides. And so if you are looking for the description of some functionality, I invite you to look into the user guide. You just type the keyword for that. If you don't find what you are looking for, then have you ever heard about the annotated dictionaries? So you would go to our code repository and I'm going to show it to you. So you go on GitLab and you follow the path etc, case dict, and annotated. And here there is really a precious source of information and a sort of documentation as well, where you can find the standard OpenFOAM dictionaries, but all documented. So if I open a random one like Blockmesh that everyone knows, You are going to have some examples, but we also have some more, let's say, documented. I scroll down, for instance, to SnappyX Mesh Dictionary. So if you don't know which keywords we have there, or if you want some more descriptions, then feel free to check out the annotated dictionaries. And last but not least, if you haven't found yet what you were looking for, then, and you don't know how something it is implementing, how something it is working, then yeah, the ultimate source of truth is the source code that is open source and can be found online. And we just saw the GitLab repo. So moving forward, we actually go to the topic for today. So post-processing, and here is my first question. The one that are going to answer correctly are going to get one of our gadgets. It's to keep up after lunch, to keep you awake. So how to get further insights on the stability and convergence of your simulations via function objects? Who would like to answer? Possibly not my colleagues. Any idea? Yeah. Yeah, so that's one of the options, but I don't know if you are aware of, but we do have some specific function objects that are going to print out either to the log file or also to disk in our post-processing folder, some additional information on the simulation itself. So we have what we call a solver info function object, and it's going to report about the performance of our simulation. And here you see an example of the output that this function object is providing. So you would have some data file, runtime, the solver that you are using for the specific field, and then the residuals, initial and final, and number of iterations to solve that equation. And you can just specify the fields for which you want these informations, and then you are getting these printed in the post-processing folder. You can also write the residual fields, and you can visualize the local residuals on your mesh, and you just need to switch on this functionality with the write residual fields. So at the write time frequency that you decide for, then you are going to get those fields printed out or saved to disk. And everyone, they take initial residuals, column, and then the number of the variable for which you are computing the residuals. So, and how do you know which fields and data are saved to the object registry by the function object? Anyone has an idea? Or do you even know that you could do that? So this is a tricky question, and I learned myself not a long time ago. We have maybe someone from the online. Yeah. So you can check out what is saved to the object registry by the function objects looking into your case. You go to the time folder, uniform folder, and then you have a function object folders if you have any function object active, and then you will have function object properties file, and there all the fields that that are saved to object registry are going to be reported there, and you can check that out. And it's going to look like that, such a file. Here it's from a small tutorial. And here you see I had the solver info function object activated. And then you see all the fields that we saw before that are also printed to the dat file are reported here. And you could call these variables then by other function objects and do further post-processing on that. But we will see that, and I will stress it several times during the presentation. And Here is just a list for the solver info function object of what is saved to object registry that you can then reuse with other function objects. So initial residuals, final residuals, and the number of solver iteration per field. Moving forward, another way to check your simulation is to use the continuity error function object. So continuity errors are printed to the log file by default. This is an additional way to save those data also to the post-processing folder. And here you see for the for continuity here, we have again a table with time, local continuity error, global and cumulative one. And then you can simply use a gnuplot or a Python script to print out your data and check the convergence. So standard convergence graph. Here you also have the flag whether you want to print this output to the log file or not. It's going to be a little bit redundant information because if we look here, so we have the standard line continuity errors in the log file from the solution, and then you will also have them rearranged here from the function object in your log files. So a matter of taste whether you want to print it out or not to the log file as well. Last but not least, a good indicator also whether your simulation is converging or not, and whether your fields stay in the supposed bounds of validity or physical values, is to use the field min-max function object. It's going to print out the values, min and max values of the variables that we specify of the fields, and also their location, and in case you are running in parallel, also on which processor you have those points or cells where we have the min and max values. So here you are going to specify the fields for which you want min and max, and the location is always switched on by default. You can switch it off if you want less information in your log file. And in the output. So here you are going to have, again, field minmax.dat file in your post-processing folder, and they are arranged like that. So you have the different lines with the time, and then for each variable that you are printing min and max, you will have a line with the values, location, and the processor location. In the log file, it's gonna look like that. And you'll have, you see the ID of the cell, its location, and the processor if you are running in parallel. And of course, also here again, the function object is storing data to the object registry. So if you want to do some further post-processing on these min and max values, you can reuse those variables simply calling them in your additional function objects. And here are the names of the variables. So the naming convention, how we save them. Okay, so let's move to some sampling and analyzing our data. And for instance, you might have some local experimental data that you would like to compare to your simulation. For instance, you have some probes located in your experiments and you are getting either pressure, velocity, whatsoever, or you might have some analytical solution for comparisons to your simulation. And what you can do with function object is either to get some local data from your simulation. So you would do some like point sampling, either with sets or probes. We'll come to that in a moment. Or you can also compute some integral values. So you would sample the values on a surface, for instance, on a cutting plane, and then you can do some operation on those values, like averaging and so on. And then you can compare those data, for instance, with your experimental ones. So if we look at the local, let's say, sampling, what we have, it's like probes function object. This is the easiest way, like you are gonna give a list of points, location, and then we are going to sample the fields that that we need, that we desire, and we are going to write them to the in a chosen output format. And if we do that, we will have a file looking like this. So in the comments in the header, we will have the number of the probes, some identifier, and then the location of the probe that we actually specified in our function object dictionary. And then at the frequency that we would like to sample, we will have the data at the different probes. And then you can plot those data, or as I said before, you can reuse them. You can also have the option not to write all those sample data to the to disk if you want to save some space. So you will change your settings here in the probes dictionary to write control none. So I'm not writing anything to disk. I switch on the sample on execute to true, and this is going to store all this set of data per field on my into the object registry. And then I can take that and I can reuse it in other function object. We will see an example in a moment. So the probes are the probes function object is allowing us to specify just a list of points. If we want to have more option to work with for the sampling, then we can use the type sets. And for this, we have for the sampling different types. So we can have an array. We can have, again, a cloud of points. We can sample values on faces or a line. So different types. And we also have, again, different output formats. So, and lately we introduced for the sets, the set format probes. So the output is gonna resemble in the one that we had before. Because if you would use something different, so like the raw format here, you're gonna get an output that is not really user-friendly. So it's gonna save, for instance, for it, it's gonna save into the post-processing folder at each time step, as is a folder for each time step, and then the file with the sample values into that time step folder. I don't find it personally very handy, so I would recommend to use this new format, and then you will have an output like the one that we saw before. Okay, one important note is that here, if you have the type cloud for your points list, and you have more than one point here, then what you are going to get as an output here for each probe is actually the average value, the special average for those points. And but if you have just one point, then the average is going to correspond to the punctual value for that. As I said before, we can reuse that. And for instance, here we can couple the sets or the probes function object with the value average. So if we have our signal, for instance, here I'm sampling the temperature field in a certain point. I have these values per time step stored into the object registry. I take them and I want to compute the time average values. Then I'm going to call the value average function object. And then with these special entries, so it is using the output of some function object. And here we put the name of the function object that we have here. And then as a field, we are going to use the output of this function object that is stored into the registry, like average PN, the name of the point here, and then the field. And here, for the value average, then we have all the functionality, so we can set a time start. So maybe we want to wait that our simulation reaches steady state. So we will start the averaging a little bit later on. And then we can also have the windowing activated for the average. And there is an example of the output. So as I was saying, we have our sampled value of the temperature at a certain point over time, and then we can compute the average and we can plot it in gnuplot or something fancier. Okay, the other option is to get integral values from sampled surfaces or sampled volumes or regions. And here it's an example now with the sampled surfaces. So we are going to call the function object surfaces from the sampling library. And Here we can have different surface types that we can call either like a cutting plane, as you see here at the bottom, or distance surface, isosurfaces, or actually the sample tree surface mesh, so that we are providing an STL file or OBJ and we are sampling. What is important to know for the sample tree surface mesh is that it's going to be the, so we are simply taking our STL file and then we are cutting our geometry and we're just projecting or interpolating the values from the mesh to this STL. So your result is going to be dependent on the resolution of the STL file. This doesn't happen for the distance surface type because this one is going to intersect your domain and then we are going to regenerate, let's say, the sample surface and then map the points. So here you will have a standard, let's say, resolution for your sample surface. Very important information also, but I guess I'll come to that. Yeah, I can tell you here. So if you want to reuse the data here of your sample surfaces in other function object, actually you need to switch off the interpolation and mainly the interpolation. The triangulation is not mandatory, but the interpolation, yes. So you will get the data from the cells here and they're not going to be interpolated on the surface. On top of that, what we want to do is we don't want to save all these sample surface data on the disk most of the time. If we have big cases, we want to save space, but we just want to use the sample data then for other operations. And so we can avoid saving those data, setting the surface format to none, and then we can use the flag store true to store our data into the object registry again. And then we are going to use those data for other operations. And if we are doing that, for instance, we can call the surface field value function object. It is going to read the region type function object surface. This surface has been stored from the surfaces function object into the object registry with the name of the, now here it's not matching, I'm sorry. The name would be sample surfaces dot, and then the name of the surface you gave here. And then you can do any operation on the fields that you sampled. In this case, a simply area average of the pressure field on that sample surface. So here more in detail, you can do various operations, and here you'll have the link to the surface field value function object. And here a long list of all the possible operation that you could do with this function object. And it's not only reading the function object surface type, it's also reading phase zone, patches, and sample surface itself. But for instance, you could sample the data on one on more surfaces or on just one surface and then reuse those sample data for different operations without having to sample again and again within the surface field value function object. And again, guess what you can do with the output of this function object from the surface field value? I guess you might have learned already. They are all shy. So, of course, you can also store the output of this function object again into the object registry and reuse it for even further operations. Okay, just a note here. So we saw sample surfaces. And similarly to the surface field value operation, we also have volume field operations in the post-processing. And the function object here is going to be called vol field value. And also here is gonna take some region type. In this case, either we take all the cells of our mesh or a cell set or a cell zone. If you are giving a cell set or cell zone, then you need to specify the name of it into the dictionary here. And then you'll have your you'll define your fields that you want to sample, and you can already apply some operation on your fields, like min, max, some averaging or integration. And you have a couple of more options, like some scaling factors, and then you can decide whether or not to write the fields or do any additional post-operation weighting operation. And again, here, storing your data into object registry in case you need it. Okay, now the next topic will be to use the function object outputs to manipulate your simulations at runtime. And you can do that using the runtime control function object. So this function object is providing you a way to manipulate your case at runtime based on a set of conditions. And during simulation, if you are satisfying these conditions or not, then you can decide whether to terminate the simulation and write the calculation data to disk, or to start additional function object by setting some triggers. And as conditions, you can use different types of them. So for instance, you could look at the maximum number of iterations for the solution of one of your equation. In the example here, we have a condition on the velocity field, and we don't want that. We don't want to exceed the maximum number of iterations of 100. Or we can use the output of other function objects, as I said before. So for instance, you will have activated in your case the force coefficients function object. So you are computing CD, so drag and lift coefficients in your of your case. And then you can use, for instance, here, the drag coefficients field. You compute its average, and you're gonna set a condition on that. Another option is, as we saw before, we were computing the average value of this temperature of the temperature in the sample point. So again, in this case, here we are using the trigger option. So it's not a condition, but we are triggering it. So we are triggering the average. And it's gonna take, again, as before, the sample points function object that we created before, the output of that, and then using it as a trigger. A note to this function object is that we have an option called nWriteStep, and this entry can be used to write all the field data each time the conditions are satisfied for a specified number of steps prior to the termination. And you can use that, like for instance, if your simulation is not fulfilling one of your conditions. For instance, you set a condition on the residuals and you see that the simulation is exploding, and you are telling to your simulation, stop the simulations if the residuals are blowing up, then OpenFOAM is going to stop the simulation for you and is going to write the last three or whatever number of time steps you give, such that you can debug your case right before the crash or the stop. And last but not least is the data visualization topic. So we were talking about sampling data on surfaces, and here is the example from before. And again, for big cases, we don't want to save all those data or all these sample surfaces to the disk. We just want to have them into the object registry. And we want to reuse this data, either for the operations that we saw before, but we can also use them at the same time to create pictures for our post-processing or to show afterward. So, and then with the visualization tool, we are just saving PNGs, a couple of megabytes mostly, and no many gigabytes of data on your disk. So for that, we have the runtime post-processing function object that is going to generate images assembling scene objects like lines, points, surfaces. And those objects, of course, are typically produced by the other function objects. And it's important to stress that the function object has a dependency on the VTK library. And for using it, you need to install or to activate the visualization module that is present in OpenFOAM since version 2006. The visualization itself, so runtime post-processing function object, is there since a longer time, but then it has been packed into the visualization module, and you'll need to activate that when you install your OpenFOAM version. And with that, as I said, you can create static images or a sequence of that. And with those images, even saved at each time step, you can create nice videos of your simulation. You can also have some freedom in choosing like the colors for the color bar, which variables to print out. You have different camera modes, and optionally the camera can also move. So if we look into the function object itself, how it looks like, we will have a lot of settings here to fill. But we will have, so the main parts of the function object are some image properties. So for the output settings, and here we will have, you can decide a custom name for your image and also the size. Of course, we have some default values here. As I said before, you can use either default settings for the coloring, or you can also set your own colors for the background, the text, edge, surface, line, a little bit as you are used in ParaView when you set up your view there. And if you are unsure, we also have a config file into the annotated dictionary in the location I was showing you at the very beginning, and you can have a look at that. Furthermore, we can also add text to our picture, and you can put some string here, what you want to print. You have some freedom in choosing the location, the size, and how you want your text to look like. And then, who of you knows how to set up the camera views? This is the most tricky part, actually, in this function object. Any idea? No one using runtime post-processing? Yes. You earned one of the best gadgets, that is the bottle opener from ESI. Okay, so from ParaView, exactly. So what you would do, like you set up your simulation, you might run a couple of time steps to start with. You open one of them in ParaView, and then in ParaView, you will have these, you will, for instance, do your cutting plane or prepare what you want to see actually in your picture. And then in ParaView, you'll have this tiny button here with the camera and the pencil. And this is going to open this, this window where you can adjust the camera settings. And so what you will need to add here in OpenFOAM, in the OpenFOAM dictionary, it's actually the entries here for the position of the camera, the focal point, and the view, such that what you are going to print out in your figure is going to be like what you are seeing now in ParaView on your screen. If you do that, I didn't report it here, the settings, but you can also see them in our tutorials, and also because they are case specific. And then we come to the actual objects that we want to see in our picture. So we can print either lines or surfaces. If we have lines here, again, reusing some other function object that we applied. So we have the streamlines function object with which you can generate the streamlines, and then you can add them with some that maybe colored by the velocity field with a certain within a certain range, in this case, velocity between 0 and 20. You can modify the visualization style, like for instance with tubes here, and those are going to be added to your picture. On top of that, you can visualize surfaces, and here we have many different types of surfaces. So you can add your actual geometry, your OBJs or STLs to the picture. In this case, represented as a surface. And I would say, like with feature edges, you can activate them or not, visualize them or not. And then you can also add cutting planes, for instance, the one that we were generating before. So you are going to call, again, the function object surface type with the naming that we had before. So the name of the sample surface, and then dot the name of the actual surface that you want to visualize. You can add glyphs as a representation, and then again, color it by the fields. You can also visualize directly patches from your case, and you just need to call the respective type. And then here you will just have a list of your patches that you want to print to your picture. And also regular expression are accepted, of course. And then here all the settings for its representation. Again, another type is the ISO surfaces. And here again, you're gonna create your ISO surfaces, and you can color them with a different field and just setting the range for it. So your picture at the end might look like the one here in the background. So with some tubes for the streamlines, with the glyphs for the velocity field, color bar, some extra text that we added. And if you have a set of them with the frequency you were saving them, then you can simply create a video or a GIF, an animation. And I just put one of the many conversion command line tools that you could use to convert your image. And if you haven't found what you were looking for your post-processing, what you can do? I give you a suggestion here. You have two good answers. Exactly. So the good answer would have been, from a marketing point of view, check out our services offering on our website. But the alternative answer, it's also you can use the coded function object. So you can, so we have this infrastructure with coded function object, and you can just call that. Here it's a very tiny example from our tutorial collection. So the coded function object is just providing you an interface for dynamic code compilation, and then here, you will just have to select the type coded among the utility function objects library. You can give a name to the coded function object itself. And then you have different options here how to write your code. And here is just an example how to look up one of the fields, in this case, the velocity. And then you can do operations on them. You can do very funky things, actually, with a coded function object. It's really up to the user and to your needs. Just a note for the ones that running big cases on distributed system. So the user here should take care that each processor can read the dynamic code folder. So this is not done automatically in OpenFOAM, but this is just a note really for the people using distributed system in this case. And with this, I'm going to close out. You can get in touch with us if you want to explore our services or our training offer, or you can also get in touch with us if you would like to get involved around activities of OpenFOAM. There is a dedicated page on our website on how to get involved, either if you would like to contribute to the source code or to contribute to the new documentation project, or what what would be better than getting involved, joining us? So we have two open positions, actually. One is an OpenFOAM developer position based in Bracknell in the UK. And the other one is of a project engineer for CFD based in Germany in our Munich office. And with this, I would like to thank you for your attention, and we have definitely plenty of time for your questions. Yeah. 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 Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Maybe Matthias can help me in the audience. Yes. Oh, so this is something very specific. And I guess first thing is would be like to open a GitLab issue with your wish. to point out that is not yet available, and then so usually we don't port everything, but if there is a special wish from the community, we can definitely consider it. Yeah. The very last improvements, they will definitely affect the performance of the force coefficients function object, because we noticed it was slowing down the simulation. I mean, it had an effect on the simulation time at the end when it was active, and we definitely improved on the performances of the function object. When it comes to the output stayed the same, but in one of the former releases, the output of the function object itself changed a little bit. So the dat file, how it is looking, how it is structured, it changed a little bit. So this might be affecting then your post-processing, perhaps outside OpenFOAM. Computational cost, it improved. So I would suggest you to definitely to use 2306 for that. Yeah. Is it possible to integrate velocity in a plane using function object? I would say so. At least we have the sum operation, but we do also have integration. So yes, So among the various operations that we saw here, so we are sampling the plane, and then we can do all those operations on the field that we are sampling. Here I had a scalar field, but of course we can also have a vector field. And if we would have velocity here and pick up one of the other operations, it's definitely possible. And it can be a weighted operation, like with some weight field, or just area weighted. Any other, yeah, definitely. So I didn't show it here, but like in the standard controls of the function objects, you have these entries. Here we have some of them, like write control and then execute interval. You will use write control, and in your case it could be, for instance, time step, but then you also have what is not written here, write interval option, and then you can decide at which intervals you are going to write your field. Yeah, definitely. No, I mean more than one, like not every time step, but I like every 10 time steps, or then so at higher frequency, yeah, or actually no, lower frequency. You, for instance, you have steady state simulation and your time step is going to be one, right? And you run your simulation for 100 iterations, but you don't want to save the probes data at each time step. Yeah. Yeah. So you can do that if you are computing the solution at that time step. Yeah, so you can choose the interval at which to write. This can be different from the standard write time of your simulation, and it can be as small as your time step delta t, but it can be bigger. Yeah, maybe we can pick it up afterward with an example also for an unsteady case, and then we can check the settings. Any other question? Yeah.
So,
yeah. But it's very basic.
Yeah, does the quantum work?
I think not. I think you, or We can check it also afterward, this one. I can give you the links also for the other function objects with the field expressions. Yeah, I was showing it before. In general. Oh, about this one. We can check it up also later. But I guess it's not the right dictionary, right? No, yeah. How can we assess the object registry during runtime? It depends what you want to do. So if the question is to assess it directly, to call stuff saved into the object registry, then you would do like we did before, calling the outputs of the function objects. And for function objects, yeah, it depends on the object. So we saw different examples. We can check out like one of them. For instance, here we had saved the sample points, and then from the function object we had some fields saved. In this case, we are taking the average of it. And for the naming convention, you need actually to look into the documentation or to look into the object registry file for the function object itself. So here are some examples of the names that are of the naming convention of the fields that are saved by the function objects. And if we go up here, here we go. Here you can check the names that that we have, or actually the fields or the variables that we had saved to the object registry. And you can reuse them. Yep. This is for the openfoam.com version, so from ESI. I don't know. I can't tell you. So I'm not sure how it is implemented in the other version. It can be very likely that you will need to change some settings to do that, and if they are present at all. Okay, any other question? Yeah. So you want to do operations? Yeah. Yeah, then I guess there is actually the I didn't put it here. It changed name. So now it should be called multi-field value function object. So you could do the sampling and the averaging on different surfaces, patches, whatever it is. And then you can combine the results of each one with this multi-field value function object. I didn't put it here because, to be honest, it's not 100% well documented, but you will have an example in the header file of the code. And we are also using it in tutorials. So there are definitely examples in the repository for that. Okay, so if there is no other question, I guess we can close the session. Of course, I'm gonna be here the entire week, my colleagues as well. So just stop us in the corridor around and ask your questions. Thank you.